When I was a kid, I used to watch Kenny Rogers drink orange juice from Florida. Does anybody remember that ad campaign? He looked like he was really enjoying it. Citrus is part of the identity of that state, of Florida. Everybody knows the orange on the license plate. But what they don't know is that over the last 20 years, Florida citrus production has declined by 94%. They're crediting a disease called HLB, but if they really want to solve this problem, I think they're going to have to look a little deeper in the mirror. I was talking with one of my conventional producers that was participating in the study, and he said that the fibrous roots on his trees were gone. Most of the trees in the orchards look like the one with the antibiotic can in it, where they've eliminated a lot of the vegetation from the soil with herbicides. And I explained to him that I was meeting producers that were restoring orchards. They were bringing them back into productivity. And one of the tricks that they were using is by planting vegetation from trunk to trunk. And he said that if that was true, then that flew in the face of everything that the industry was being told by their advisors. And I asked him the question of, how's all that advice working? And he thought about it for a second, and he said, yeah, you're right. They aren't really looking out for us little guys. As a scientist, very few people had better stats than I did. By many metrics, I was a very successful agroecologist and entomologist, but I could drive from my house in South Dakota over to Minnesota where my parents lived. Things weren't getting better. Rural communities were continuing to decline, climates were changing, pollution is rampant, the bees are dying, people are sick, farmers are sick, and I had to ask myself that question of, if I'm a scientist that's supposed to be helping farmers really solve these issues, how's it working? And I didn't have a good answer for that, so I quit my job. I decided that if I really wanted to connect with these problems that we are facing on a planetary scale, and our food system is a part of that, then I would have to become a farmer. And so I literally bought the farm. I've never had to learn so much so fast. You know, scientists were never meant to be experts at farming. We were always meant to be servants of farmers. The farmers are the experts at farming, right? We can take what they're doing, we can scale it, we can transfer it, we can help to understand why it might be working, but the farmers are the ones that are making these successful systems work on their operations. And one of these successful systems is called regenerative agriculture. Regenerative ag, in a nutshell, grows soil, fosters life while producing nutritious food profitably. To do this, the most regenerative operations haul out a number of practices or principles. They never till the soil. Uniform soil disturbance is not good. They cover that soil with living roots. Plant diversity is so important in a regenerative system. They're integrating perenniality and livestock into these cropping systems. They're reducing or completely eliminating synthetic herbicide or pesticides and fertilizer use. When they have animals, they keep those animals tight, they move them frequently, and they allow that pasture to rest and recover. But fundamentally, regenerative farmers grow food and fiber for their families and their communities. They celebrate life on their farms. We decided to conduct some science to try to document whether regenerative agriculture actually delivers on some of these bold promises that it makes. So we started what's being called the 1,000 Farms Initiative. Over the last 3 years, we've deployed from that little blue triangle scientific teams to 1,284 farms across North America in 30 states and 2 Canadian provinces. You can tell by the gaps on the maps where we're headed next. we use across all of these 35 different food systems that we've examined thus far in replicate, we've used harmonized methods so that we can compare and contrast. We're examining the ecosystem in many of its facets, simultaneously looking at the socioeconomics and the nutrition of the foods that are being produced there. These farms span from very conventional all the way to very regenerative. That wasn't photoshopped, by the way. That was just happens to be a really good example of almond production. Such that, you know, each of these farms falls along a continuum, but we can record the management and then scale or correlate that with some of the outcomes that we're measuring. Some of these outcomes are showing us just what this food system can do. You know, for millions of years, one of the ways that the planet has regulated greenhouse gases is by putting carbon in the soil. We measured that under regenerative versus conventional operations. If we were to devote all of the row crops, this is like things like corn, soybeans, wheat, that kind of stuff, over to fully regenerative production in the United States, we could store 12 billion tons of carbon dioxide equivalents in the soil. And that's not just on the thinnest top layer where that carbon is really labile. That's deep down, 30 to 60 centimeters, we end up seeing these changes happening within these regenerative systems. Now, there's a lot of questions that we still have to answer about that. How fast does that carbon storage happen? What are the relative emissions from these two different systems? If this is just row crops, what if we looked at livestock systems or perennial orchard systems? Suffice it to say, our data strongly suggests that regenerative ag might be one of our last best chances for trying to get carbon out of the atmosphere and put it back into the soil where it belongs. I was talking with one of the farmers. He was Amish up in upstate New York. He ran a dairy. And I was explaining all of the things that we were measuring on his farm. I was telling him, okay, about the soil carbon. You know, we're looking at it at different strata down. And then we were also measuring the chemical and physical properties of the soil as well as water and how it reacts with that soil. And he nodded. He was interested. And then I said, we're also going to name all of the bacteria and fungi in your soil. And his eyes got a little brighter. And we're also going to name and count all of the insects that we're finding out here, and the birds, and the plants. And every time, he got a little more interested in what we were doing. And I later asked him why that biodiversity seemed to resonate so strongly with him. And he explained that as part of his faith, humans, farmers, were always meant to be stewards of life. And that of all of the scientific groups that were studying all of the things about his farm, nobody was telling him about the life on his farm. Regenerative agriculture fundamentally celebrates life. Don't ever forget that, okay? And what we've been discovering is from the 10,000 species that we've now named from our food system, this is a really large bioinventory, that regenerative practices invariably increases every single one of these organismal groups. And not only that, but when we look at the abundance and the diversity and the biomass of these different organismal groups, things like bacteria, fungi, birds, you name it, all of that scales with how much carbon is in the soil. If you want carbon in the soil, manage life on farms. The carbon will take care of itself. There's a lot of currencies that influence us in this world, right? Economics is just one of those currencies. Our data on the economics of these systems suggests that you don't lose money by going regenerative. That's important, right? In these row cropping systems, we may produce a little bit less yields, but in foods we don't eat, right? If we really wanted to feed a growing human population, you'd grow food and then get it where it's supposed to go. But even so, these farmers don't have to sacrifice yields, all right? When we ask these farmers, regenerative farmers, what sorts of things were motivating their decisions. What scored the highest was soil health, was the health and wellness of their families, was environmental stewardship. And yes, profit was in there, but it wasn't the most important. By learning these drivers of social change that's already happening within our food system right now, we can help to scale it up even faster. I'm a data guy. I thought that the most important aspect, the most important outcome of this science was going to be that data. But now I understand just how important that connection is with the people that we're studying, right? How important it is for them just to be seen. So I don't know when we leave a farm what it is that we're going to find there. I mean, that's the whole point of doing the science. But when I leave that farm, those farmers know that we care about them. We care about their farm. We care about their family. And that level of connection, that is something that's totally different than the science that's being used to inform global food policy and the potential of our food system for solving climate mitigation right now. A lot of times within this regenerative space, the industry data isn't supporting what these farmers are doing. These farmers are doing things that conventional production science says can't happen, quite frankly. And so as a scientist, I'm faced with this issue of I need to make damn sure that the data that I am collecting is reflecting the reality. And if I get that wrong, then we're not going to know what's possible for our food system to do in terms of these planetary scale problems, right? I was in Maine working with some wild blueberry farmers up there, and they were an elderly couple, and they were at the end of their careers. They had spent their entire lives working with small blueberry production and supporting that against this rising tide of industrialization of their industry that would crush their communities. And they're in their 80s, and they're at the end of their lives, and they just wanted to know that somebody cared, that it mattered, that everything that they had risked throughout their entire lives, that it wasn't just going to be forgotten. And in drives this caravan of three crappy minivans and spills out this team of young, enthusiastic scientists that think that this farm is the coolest farm they've ever seen. I learned very late in life that when measuring the beauty and the wonder of this world, the most important tool that a scientist has is their heart. Thank you.